From the unprecedented four judges conference in January last year to some landmark judgments to the Collegium's appointment of judges, the judiciary, especially the Supreme Court of India, has been making the headlines with great frequency and perhaps even stoking controversy. To understand what's going on and to assess the independence of the judiciary and the health of its relationship with the executive during the 5 years of the BJP-led NDA government, I'm talking today on Off Center to eminent jurist and Supreme Court advocate Fali Nariman. Mr. Nariman, thank you so much for talking to us. How would you assess how the judiciary has performed in terms of its independence and in terms of the balance that you talk about? Vis-a-vis the executive.
There may be a few exceptions here and there which you can point out and I can point out, but by and large, I don't think there has been very much change. The judiciary has strived to maintain its independence. Mm. Sometimes it has succeeded, sometimes it has not. There has always been this little confrontation between the law minister and one of the judges or the chief justice or someone like that. Occasionally that happens. Yeah. But that, I think, is the health, shows that we are still a healthy, vibrant democracy. I prefer it. I don't think that everyone should get on with everybody else necessarily at all times. I mean, there's no such thing.
So how did you react to the four judges press conference that was held just a little over a year
ago? I've written a book about it.
I know. Yeah. God save the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
I know that.
Well, that was a little out of the ordinary, I thought. It was never been done. And that's what I said also. We'll probably, later history will probably tell us if somebody wishes to write something.
You say that the four judges press conference and the open letter they wrote to the then Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, challenging his functioning and even sort of imputing, imputing motives to his decision making. Do you think that has damaged the reputation and the credibility of the judiciary?
It hasn't damaged the credibility of the judiciary, but it has certainly damaged the image. Hmm. The image has taken a beat because, as I told some of the people who were at the forefront of this sort of campaign against the Chief Justice, I said that, look here, if you feel that something is wrong and done by the Chief Justice, the former Chief Justice, then certainly go ahead. But, as I have written in the book, you have to shoot to kill.
Yeah, not to hurt.
Not to hurt, because then you hurt not the man himself or the woman himself. You hurt the system. And that's what's happened. That's the problem. They all threatened, including one political party, that we will impeach him, we will do this and we will do that, and it all fizzled out.
Yeah.
Nobody even attempted to impeach anybody.
Would it be fair to say, Mr. Nariman, that since then it's sort of open season where the judiciary is concerned, isn't it? In terms of media criticism, in terms of politicians making
Everybody is entitled to have a shot at the judiciary
now,
once you go public.
Yeah.
And since they went public, there were a lot of people said a lot of things.
Mr. Nariman, it seems to me that, you know, some of the stuff that is discussed today about lawyers, about judges, about, you know, their relationships with each other, with the executive, with politicians, with business houses, all of this, it seems to me, is something that was known in the elite, you know, in the elite circles
but
of
not
power,
talked about.
And it's only the common man, it's only lay people like me who had great illusions about how this was the institution that was like Caesar's wife, isn't it? So is it a good thing today that the public is questioning the judiciary?
I think it's a good thing. There's nothing wrong in questioning motives, questioning, so long as you do it within the bounds of reason, because of the fear of the contempt jurisdiction, the criminal contempt jurisdiction, which is still there. It's still there. A lot of people, for instance, a lot of advocates also have said that it all should be abolished, like it is abolished in England. But I don't know whether we are quite yet
ready for it.
So it's far better to let people let off steam in various, and But on occasions, it is necessary also to have denials. So I have always advocated that we should have a special registrar in the Supreme Court to look into not only all the press cuttings, clippings, etc., but to make the necessary denials, which is very, very important, because the people must also read that such and such a thing which was reported in such and such a paper is not quite correct because.
So, if I were to look at the four judges' case,
I think that's something to the detriment of the Supreme Court. They have not yet provided for a registrar, you call him what you like, a registrar of advertisements or registrar,
an official statement.
Registrar, publicity registrar, not seeking publicity, but denying false publicity.
Right.
It's very important because the public wants to know. And it comes to know not only from the electronic media, but from the print media as well.
So the four judges and the Chief Justice of the then Chief Justice of India, Deepak Mishra case, would how should it have been resolved from the side of the then Chief Justice? What would you advise?
I don't know whether I should advise at all, but my own view is, and I've expressed this in the book, that it was an aberration which should never have happened. It was unfortunate for the four gentlemen who had this press conference that, see, these things are,
but they
are serious, not done.
But they seriously once you start damaged his credibility,
yes,
isn't
because
it?
Once you start a press conference, you must remember, then it's out open in the public.
Yeah.
It's fair game for everybody to say anything he wants against any judge. And once you start, once the judges themselves say something about the Chief Justice, that was perhaps a prime motive for the impeachment motion, which was sought to be moved.
But his silence is, was his silence advisable? Can you say?
I think the silence ultimately was much better than his speaking out. Things would have gone much worse,
Okay.
Because then there would have been more allegations and still more allegations. It's very difficult, you see, to prove these things. That's the problem. It's very, very difficult. In a court of law, you require evidence. Somebody has to say something, and you have to prove it. Someone has to put his oath to it. Someone has to produce a document. All that sort of stuff required.
It's not like what we do on social
it's
media.
It's not like what you do.
One tweet and another tweet and a little battle and then you scoot.
Yeah. And this sort of tweeting has, of course, now become so common, even presidents of the world to start tweeting to each other about each other, about problems. Which so to me, of course, is remarkable. I am, of course, as old as the Himalayas. So
today, when you look at the way the Collegium continues to function, the opacity, the lack of lack of method, which is a process which we don't need to know, but at least to know that there is a method and what it is. Do you feel somewhere that the NJAC could have provided a suitable alternative?
In fact, you see, It did provide. The Venkatachala Commission, which was a commission to look into the working of the Constitution after 20 years. Chief Justice Venkatachala, a very distinguished former Chief Justice of ours, looked into it and proposed what is known as the Venkatachala formula, which we call the Venkatachala, which said there will be a commission, not the collegium. There will be a commission, a judicial commission. Three senior most judges with the Chief Justice of India, the law minister, and one other person, the attorney general or someone whom they appoint, makes no. But the majority has to be with the judges of the Supreme Court. I mean, that is what he said. And that would fit into the basic structure of the Constitution, because by that time the basic structure doctrine had come in. That is to say, don't do anything which goes contrary to what the Constitution envisages. Now, when I appeared in the National Judicial Commission case, I myself told the judges, the five judges, that I will withdraw this commission, this petition, if the government implements that Venkatachala Commission report. I don't mind. I don't want anything to be called a collegium rather than a commission. Call it a commission, but implement it. Because under the Act, what was it? There was six people.
And more political.
No.
Not a politician.
Where the judges were in a minority.
Yeah.
Which can't possibly be. And there were to be two eminent person.
Yes.
Without defining those persons, yes, whoever
yes,
they were.
Yes.
You see, I personally am against any statue because our constitution had some vision. It appointed one person as Chief Justice of India. There always has to be a Chief Justice of India. There can't be an acting Chief Justice of India. Please remember. Only a Chief Justice of India. And that's the person in whom there's a repository of making recommendations, deciding cases, fixing benches, etc.
Sure.
Now, if that had been followed, whether you had one good, one bad, one good, one bad Chief Justice, it goes on like this.
Sure, sure.
After all, we had about 200 odd Supreme Court judges over the years.
Yes.
Some have been good, some have been very good, some have been excellent, some have been not so good. That's all part of the game. It's always like that.
So
it makes no difference. In my personal view is that this arrangement ought perhaps to have been continued, namely one Chief Justice, but Justice Verma, because of certain historical antecedent, the benches being fixed by the government, the government saying that we want people who have the philosophy of the government at heart, and all that sort of thing used to happen in Mrs. Indira Gandhi's time. We well known that. So he introduced this system. I'm not sure whether this system is the ideal system at all, but I think the Venkatchala formula is perhaps the only reasonable formula where you can get an opinion from outside and you get your three Chief Justices.
Right,
three
so you keep the judiciary's role paramount.
Yeah, it has to be.
Yeah, but Mr. Nariman,
because the final interpreter, which most people here don't know, the final interpreter of what the Constitution means is, whether you like it or not,
is the
Supreme Court of India.
Yeah.
They can change their view.
Yeah.
They can have three judges saying one thing, five judges saying another, seven saying a third.
Yeah.
But at the same time, that is the role which the Constitution provides, and that's why this Constitution is the only Constitution, in my view, which keeps this country together.
Just 2 months ago,
yes,
we saw Collegium take certain decisions to elevate two judges to the Supreme Court, and then reverse it. So we don't know why these things are happening.
It was disappointing. It was disappointing to me. It was disappointing to the judge who had recently retired. I told him. I complimented him. I told him, Justice Lokur is an excellent judge. He only said disappointed, and they asked him for the reason. He said, I can't give the reason. He was right on both counts. You can't give the reason. It makes no difference what you say, but it cannot be. There are certain things which cannot be said, and these are some things which cannot be said.
So,
for instance, because you otherwise denigrate somebody. You make someone feel small.
Sure.
You shouldn't be appointed, I should be appointed. He's not fit enough, I am fit enough,
right,
like that.
Given that the Collegium still continues to function in an opaque way, are you saying that India is then stuck with what we have right now?
At the moment, yes, it appears so. Because you must realize that the NJSC was passed unanimously by Parliament.
Sure.
And that was their main argument.
Yes.
They said, how are you saying that this is contrary?
Yeah.
But they said, nothing of the kind. Makes no difference whether you pass it unanimously or with a majority and so on. Makes no difference. If it violates the basic structure, it violates. And the basic structure of the Constitution is that the judiciary has the last word. I'm not very satisfied with the Collegium system. People are not satisfied. Some judge sulks and says, at the moment, until someone says something different, you have to live with it. Because that has been done by not two judges, three judges, but nine judges.
Yes.
Twice.
Yes.
73 and 75.
Yes.
So we can't live that down, unfortunately.
You talked about the Parliament passing the NJSC Act unanimously and then the judiciary, sort of striking it down. This relationship between the Parliament and the judiciary, in terms of the balance of power that you keep referring to, how do you see the role of the majority as expressed in a democracy in determining the experience of society and the destiny of a nation vis-a-vis the role that the court plays?
You see, I'm not very sure whether the majority principle is ultimately the right principle at all. And you see, majority in our system, first past the post, it doesn't require too much of a majority. A proportional representation is perhaps better, but that's too complicated.
And you'll have to enact...
Enact a law with regard to it. But this is the way we have organized our system. It sounds good. Adult franchise is extraordinarily good.
When you look at what the majority, in quotes, what the majority wants and the will of the majority as expressed through electoral democracy, through laws made in parliament, and the role of the judiciary. And if you look at this in the context of something like building the Ram Temple in Ayodhya, because we know that several religious, political, social groups, Hindu groups, wanted a law to be enacted for the temple to be constructed. Some even were okay with the idea of an ordinance to be introduced and then ratified in parliament.
And the government didn't.
How do you see the will of the majority and what the majority wants and the role of the judiciary?
That's why I said.
In the context of the Ayodhya temple. Take us through this illustration.
In the context of anything that you want to say, Ayodhya or no Ayodhya or anything. The whole problem is that there is a rethinking amongst political thinkers across the world today that whether a mere counting of heads is sufficient for a good government, mere counting of heads, or is something else required. What that something else is, God alone knows, is still to be discovered. And that's something to be really... with our intelligence, with artificial intelligence now getting into the mix, it's all very, very complicated. We are living in an extraordinary world. There's no doubt about it.
If you could weigh in, would you, aware something as incendiary or as polarizing as the building of the Ayodhya temple would be in the context of the Indian nation and what it stands for via the constitution, the Supreme Court decision or a law, what do you think would help take this matter to a acceptable, logical conclusion?
Ultimately, you see, even a law that is passed, it can be a law. There's nobody that stops
it. It can be challenged.
That's right. So no one can prevent a challenge. So anybody can challenge anything today. So there's, by and large, that's exactly what I was telling you. Under our constitution, you can imagine another one if you like. I mean, nobody is stopping you. Or nobody is stopping anybody from writing about another one. Gandhiji, for instance, didn't like this constitution. He had a different idea about it. But under our constitution, the supremacy of the judiciary, howsoever appointed, howsoever badly appointed, well appointed, etc., is supreme. No doubt about it, and we have to accept that.
The Ayodhya case, the Supreme Court earlier, Justice Kehar, when he was the Chief Justice of India, suggested mediation. The Supreme Court now, the bench hearing the case, has again suggested mediation. No one wants to decide the case in the judiciary. Is that a right? Is that a correct assessment?
Mediation is not a bad thing. I mean, mediation is something which is highly recommended. Do you know that in 2018, last year, the United Nations passed a special convention, they don't have a law, a convention which is acceptable for mediation and settlement of all affairs, commercial, for commercial matters, because they find that it is perhaps the best way rather than arbitration.
For deeply sensitive cases like the Ayodhya temple construction case, you think the mediation route is an advisable one?
Why not? If mediation is possible and if all parties are agreeable. You see, there has to be an agreement. Mediation necessarily postulates an agreement, a successful mediation.
So a Supreme Court appointed mediator would take care of this problem?
Perhaps. Hopefully it would. But I'm not sure whether that will work. Look at the mix we have. You see, it's not a Hindu state. We still have a very large number of Minorities. The Muslim is the largest minority.
Right.
And there's also a feeling today amongst them that the Muslim majority is favored because of certain articles in the which they have smuggled into the constitution called 32A. There's an article there which should not be an article because it was didn't pass the amendment.
Right.
It wasn't amended. It was done under Article 370, the presidential order.
How worried are you as someone who's championed the Indian constitution and fiercely been so fiercely protective of it? How worried are you that via amendments, constitutional amendments, of which we see so many, an increasing trend of constitutional amendments, how worried are you that the constitution will change in its essence?
Yes, it may change. It may change. I am worried. See, we should not lose our ethos. I mean, I recommended one day in Parliament when I was there as a nominated member, when they were arguing about what should be the best history book to teach people in colleges and schools. I said, don't go to a living author. Go to a dead author. Read Nehru's Discovery of India. It is one of the most exciting books. I mean, we were very young then. We were in college. And we were most inspired by it. Most inspiring. Some of the passages are a little incorrect, etc. Because he wrote it from prison.
Yes.
He didn't have all the reference books that we normally have. Amazing.
And no Google.
No, nothing, no technology at all. And look at the man who wrote that book.
So how worried are you that this constitution, that the constitution of India, that you feel so, such deep admiration for? How worried are you that it is under threat? And it is under threat from this majoritarianism that we are seeing in display.
The few years or months that I have to live, I am worried. But I'm more worried, you see, about what's going to happen in the future. Doesn't matter what happens to me. My life is gone. I mean, by and large, I mean, you can't expect to live for 100. 90 is bad enough. As I told you, I'm as old as the Himalayas, so it doesn't matter to me. But I am worried because we are a mixed group of people.
But
we are
Mr.
people
Nariman,
from all over.
But
who have different views, who have different eating habits are different. You go to any part of India, eating habits are different. The custom is different. Everything is different.
But Mr. Nariman, I have heard you talk about how the Constituent Assembly, was almost 80% Hindu.
Yes,
and they created this constitution.
Yes, of course.
Why would you have less faith in the majority Hindu community today? I'm playing devil's advocate.
Because you see, nowadays people didn't preach the way they preached in the old days. In the old days that look at all the old-time politicians. Even look at Mr. Vajpayee. He was, although he belonged to the BJP, he belonged to the RSS. He was one of the most accommodating persons who wanted peace around in the continent, apart from peace in India. These are people one admires. One admires not because they belong to a political party, one admires because they were real leaders. I want to see more leaders of national importance who are. So don't ask me who is the leader. I won't answer you. Who is that leader? I don't know. He probably has to be born, and he will be born. I have great confidence that India will remain India as long as India remains India and as one country.
One of the biggest criticisms leveled against the BJP-led NDA government is the impact it has had on the independence and the integrity of institutions. You've been legal counsel for Alok Verma, the ousted CBI chief. Do you think this government has been specially bad on this front, or is this what all governments have attempted
all
to do?
All governments have attempted. I have no. You see, the majoritarian governments have always been a disaster for us. Disaster. The Congress government was a disaster during the emergency. What did they do except bring on the emergency?
Sure.
They wanted to make Mrs. Gandhi the queen of India. You are aware of that.
Yes.
We are all aware of it. We forget history. See, we should read more history in order to find out. So this majoritarian government which is there is always a problem, because they want to then establish whatever they want.
So you're not a worried man today when people are talking about a coalition government?
Not at all. Because we have been used for 30 years. For 30 years we've had coalition government. And well, we progressed much slower than what we have progressed today, I agree. Economy has done well, the Prime Minister is right, that we have done certainly better. There's no doubt he has made a lot of progress in the economic front. But somehow, I personally believe that in our country with the mix that we have, allies in power are much better than a single unit. And the Congress explained that to us right from 72 to 75.
Are you feeling that pessimistic about the state of humankind at the moment?
Of humankind, yes. I'm very afraid of humankind more than anything else. Absolutely. Well, look at the leaders we have all over the world.
Fali Nariman, I wish you a lot of good luck. Thank you for your time.
No,
thank you.
No.